Hey guys, this is The Blazing Show with Chris. Remember when I said that we would have Daryl Davis on? Well, hell yeah, we are. Daryl, you're on.
Yep, I'm on.
Hey guys, everyone, this is Daryl Davis. Welcome.
Hey, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
No problem. I can't believe I've talking to you at last. I've only seen like videos of you, and which is very strange. You're like one of the only guys, with all due respect, that talk to KKK, but like you're not white. Like, how does that work? Like, wow. Like, please, like, talk to like. Well, before you get into that, talk a little about yourself, Daryl.
Well, I'm 56 years old, almost 57, and I'm from Chicago, Illinois, originally, but I currently live in the state of Maryland here in the United States. And I spent a lot of time overseas because my parents were U.S. Foreign Service officers.
So, wow.
You know, I grew up, you know, as an American embassy brat.
Uh-huh.
And I started going overseas at an early age, you know, back in the early 1960s. And I would attend international schools. So my classes over there were filled with kids from Japan, Germany, France, Nigeria, Italy, Russia. Anybody who had an embassy in those countries, we all went to the same school. And so that's how I grew up, around different colors, different religions, different nationalities, ethnicities. But then, you know, you're only assigned to a foreign country for 2 years, and after your two-year assignment is up, you return back here to the States. And when I would return back home, and I would be in elementary school, my classes were either all black or all white, or both black and white, you know, depending upon whether you went to the integrated school or the still segregated school. And, you know, this was a phenomenon to me. I could not understand why people were separated by color. It made no sense to me. And, you know, that's when I first, you know, began discovering racism. And then I would have experiences where people would, you know, would treat me in a racist manner or whatever. And I formed a question in my mind as a child. And the question was, how can you hate me when you don't even know me? So that's where it started.
Wow. And then, like, eventually it goes to the journey to the Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah, that was in later years as an adult. You know, I would have all these racist experiences where one time I was marching with a group of Cub Scouts. And it was an all-white group of Cub Scouts, and I was the only black scout in this parade. And some of the white spectators began throwing bottles and cans, soda pop cans, and rocks, and debris from the street at me as I was marching.
Wow,
and I had no idea. I was age 10. I had no idea why this was happening to me. And then, you know, later when I got home and I was bleeding, and my parents were, you know, putting Band-Aids on me and cleaning me up. They explained, you know, what racism was, and that was the first time I'd heard the term. And I could not believe it. I could not believe that somebody would want to hurt me who didn't even know me. So that was a point of curiosity. And so more and more incidents happened, you know, throughout my life, all because of the color of my skin, which made no sense. So as an adult, you know, I went on to college. I got my degree in music, so I'm a professional musician. That's how I make my living. But while music is my profession, understanding race was my obsession. And even as an adult, I still had not had my question answered from childhood of how can you hate me when you don't know me. So I figured, you know, I need an answer to this question. Who better to ask than somebody who would join an organization whose whole premise is hating? So that organization would be the Ku Klux Klan. So I figured, okay, well, I will go to the Ku Klux Klan.
Wow.
And I will ask the leaders and members, how can you hate me when you don't even know me?
So that sounds crazy. And your parents probably thought, Daryl, you're crazy.
Well, I've been told that before too. But, you know, I made some inroads. I got a lot of information. I also influenced a lot of them.
Wow. And then, like, how did you actually get to know them personally? Like, some of the leaders who used to, how long did that take? Like, how did that work?
Well, you know, nothing changes overnight. It took a lot of of research and understanding and reading. You know, I first started collecting books on the Klan in 1974 when I was 15 years old in 10th grade, because I'd had some more racist experiences and I wanted to understand this ideology, this mentality. So I went out and I bought books on black supremacy, on white supremacy, on anti-Semitism, you know, on the Ku Klux Klan, on the Nazis in Germany, on the neo-Nazis over here. Because I want, you know, there were no courses you could take in school like, you know, Race 101. That did not exist. I'm not even sure it exists today. But so I had to learn on my own, self-educate. And I bought all these books. I still have a very vast library on this stuff. So I read all this stuff. And I found out who the leaders were, who was prominent. And then, you know, sometimes, you know, the Klan would hold a rally in a public place. So anytime you hold a rally on public property, you know, like a Klan rally or something like that, or any kind of a rally, you must first go to the city and get a permit. So in order to apply for a permit, you have to give your name. So whenever the Klan was going to have a rally, you know, I just checked and see who applied for the permit. Well, that told me who the Klan person was. And then I would track them down. I would get their home number and address and all that kind of stuff. And I would have my secretary contact them and tell them, listen, I work for a man who's writing a book on the Klan. Would you consider sitting down and giving him an interview? And I told my secretary, do not tell them that I'm black. If they agree to do the interview and meet with me, then they can figure out that I'm black, you know, when they see me, obviously, because, you know, I don't look white. But I did not want them to know in advance. And so she would do that. And some people, you know, said they wanted nothing to do with me. You know, they did not want to, you know, talk about the Klan. There were others who said, yeah, sure. You know, I'll interview with him. You know, they didn't know I was black. And they would pick a place to go meet, you know, like a restaurant or a hotel room, something like that. Or some of them would even invite me over to their house, not knowing that I was black. So I would show up and knock on their door, and of course, you know, they'd freak out. You know, and then once they got over it, either they told me to go away, or they came out on the porch because they didn't want to let me inside, or some of them would let me inside, and we would sit in the living room or at the kitchen table and talk.
Whoa. Who, if you don't mind, like, who are one of the former leaders that you actually made friends with? One of them for like decades.
Well, I made friends with the leaders, and then, you know, during the course of, you know, over a period of time, you know, the friendship grew, and some of them decided to quit the Klan because they'd become very good friends with me, and then they became former leaders. So the people that I dealt with were active members, and now some of them are inactive. They're, you know, they're former members. They gave up those beliefs.
And like, I assume, like, anybody who's black probably thought you were crazy. So, like, how'd that go? Like, what'd your family think when they found out you did this?
Well, you know, my family, my mom had already passed. So my dad was still living. But, you know, you have to understand that my family, they're the ones who raised me. They're the ones who took me all over the world and introduced me to people of different colors, different nationalities, you know, and taught me that all people are equal.
Yes.
So, of course, I'm going to, you know, have that kind of attitude. So, you know, my father, you know, accepted me. He was concerned, of course, for my safety because it was a very, you know, dangerous undertaking that I was doing. But he understood, you know, my attitude. My black friends, you know, they accepted me because they already knew that I was crazy, like, as you point out. And then the other black people who did not know me or who did not have a chance to talk to me or read anything that I wrote or whatever, you know, they judged me to be crazy. They judged me to be a sellout, an Uncle Tom, an Oreo, all kinds of, you know, disparaging remarks were made about me because they did not understand how could I sit down with an enemy like that. But then after talking with me or after reading my book or things like that, you know, they understood. Most of them did. Some of them, you know, did not.
Wow.
But, you know, but for anybody, black or white, to judge me and what I do, whether it's with the Klan or anybody else, to judge me before they know me is doing the exact same thing the Klan is doing. My question is, how can you hate me when you don't know me? I'm asking that of the Klan. Wow. And I would ask that of any black person who would criticize me, who has not talked to me first to understand why I'm doing this. I'm doing this to better society so that we get to know each other and we can dispel the fears and myths and misinformation that we have about each other. Because we all live in this country together. We must learn to get along. If we don't, we're going to self-destroy. And, you know, the Klan has been around since 1865. I'm sorry, about 150 years. You know, so we're in 2015 right now. They're still here. Why? Maybe it's time that we get to know each other and understand one another so that we can learn how to get along. That's why I do that. And in doing so, some of those people ended up quitting, which is a good thing. So, you know, I've done my job to help create a better society. But people who just sit around and talk about, you know, you shouldn't talk to your enemy, you shouldn't sit down with these people, all they're doing is just furthering the motives.
I think you said something like that, like when you said, if you don't actually want to take a chance to talk to someone, you're actually like doing as worse as they are. You're getting to
exactly.
their level.
Precisely.
Wow. So, after that, why do you think it's hard for blacks to talk to KKK members in recent times? Because I think, like, they probably can. Like, the KKK doesn't say, I want to kill blacks. They're more of a separatist. But I don't think they would say, I want that person to die. Like, what do you think in recent times?
No. Okay, there are two ideologies. Okay? You have white separatists and you have white supremacists. A white separatist is someone who doesn't care about the other races. It's okay if they're here, but they need to live separately. They need to have their own school systems, their own neighborhoods, their own workplaces, you know, that kind of thing. Go eat at their own restaurants. You know, don't mix. Just stay separate. Okay?
Yeah, segregation.
White supremacist, on the other hand, believes that any non-white needs to leave the country. If you don't leave the country, you will be killed in the race war. It's going to be a race.
I'm sure you dealt with white supremacists.
Yeah, I dealt with them all. Okay, so the Klan is no more, you know, separatist or peaceful, you know, than it used to be. You still have a lot of acts of violence. Just, you know, what about a few months ago, a Klansman in Kansas City shot up three people that he thought were Jewish at in front of some Jewish center. They were Christian, but doesn't matter whether they're Christian or Jewish or Muslim or Hindu or anything else. You know, he hated and he shot them and killed them.
Oh, come on, that's despicable.
Pardon me?
That's despicable what he did. Three people. Wow.
Well, yeah, but there are a lot of sickos out here, and right now, you know, we're experiencing, you know, that same mentality getting ready to come into place as people are becoming very showing a phobia against. People of the Islam faith, you know, they're blaming every terrorist attack that's being done by someone who proclaims to be Muslim as being reflective of the entire religion, and it's not. You know, the Ku Klux Klan claims to be Christian, but they are certainly not representative of the entire religion of Christianity.
What about, like, so how you actually made friends with KKK, but, like, so I guess they it's more about you being real to them. And, hey, this guy is awesome, no matter what color he is. So, like, how did you actually get to be friends with him somehow?
Well, because, you can take your worst enemy. Doesn't matter who it is. It doesn't have to be about race. It could be about any controversial subject. Maybe you feel one way about abortion and they feel the other way. Or you feel one way about the war in Iraq and they feel the other way, whatever. But whatever controversy you have, no matter how extreme, if you sit down and talk to that opponent, that adversary, you will eventually find that you have some things in common. And in fact, if you keep talking, you will find that you have more things in common than you have in contrast. And what you do is you begin to build upon those things that you have in common. And then the things that you have in contrast become very trivial. They began mattering less and less. So, for example, I'm sitting down and talking to some Klan leader. All right, he hates me, and he's told me he hates me. He thinks black people are inferior. Our brains are smaller than a white brain. Therefore, we don't have the amount of intelligence. intelligence in our head that a white person would have. You know, all kinds of crazy stuff. All right. So I sit there and I listen to that. All right. And then I will rebut it. I will provide, you know, evidence, you know, that what he's saying is not exactly true. And we will question each other, et cetera. But apart from that, you know, we might find something in common. Like, we both want better education in schools for children. We want to get drugs off the street because too many kids are getting involved in drugs. Okay? That's not a white thing or a black thing. Better education is not a white thing or a black thing. It's something that benefits everybody. Everyone. You know, you might be in the Klan, you might be a neo-Nazi, but if you want to get rid of drugs off the streets and get a better education for your kids, I want the same thing, and I'm your enemy. So we have that in common. And then when we see that we have something in common, it puts a human face on each other. And you begin to, and then you slowly begin to think, well, you know, he really wants the same thing that I want. Maybe the best way to get it is to work together. Because we want that thing, and we're beating each other up, but yes, and we're not getting it. Maybe if we cooperate, maybe we can get that thing. So you build on things that you have in common. And one of the most powerful things, you know, that I came to understand and learn is that while two enemies are talking, you know, they may be arguing, they may be yelling and screaming and shouting at each other and disagreeing. That's okay. They're still talking. As long as they're talking, they're not fighting. It's when the fighting stops, I'm sorry, it's when the talking stops, that the ground becomes fertile for violence. So no matter who your enemy is, no matter what the topic is, like I said, take race out of it. It could be any other subject, or any subject at all. Sit down with your enemy and talk. Because as long as you're talking, you're not fighting. It's when you stop talking to your enemy that people can plot against each other and then start the violence. But as long as you're talking, you're not fighting. So it's always very important to keep that channel of communication open. And the more you talk to each other, the more you learn about each other. The more you learn about each other, the more human your enemy appears.
Well, and you also wrote a book called Clandestine Relationships.
That's correct.
You talk about that book? That's like describes your whole journey.
Right. I started writing the book in 1991. And it came out in 98, and right now I'm working on a revision of the book. I'm updating it.
Revision?
So I hope to have it out maybe by the end of this year.
Wait, is it like a sequel to that one?
Yeah.
Wait, so what's the difference between this one and that sequel in particular?
Okay. Well, that's a very good question, Christopher.
Like, I know you can't say much about the book, but like, exactly, what exactly is it different? Does it describe and other... like, because it's pretty much the same story, like same journey, it's the same concept. You met the clan leaders, you made friends with them, but unless you've done that recent times, maybe, I don't know.
No, I'm still involved with them, you know, to a great extent.
Say what?
But of course, okay, you know, by the end of my first book, you know, which came out at the end of 97, beginning of 98, some people, you know, had left the Klan, and they gave me their robes and hoods. I have robes and hoods, you know, Klan uniforms and things like that, you know, that now belong to me because they gave them up to me because they no longer believe in that ideology. There were others who by the end of the book were still in the Klan, still being hateful, okay, and that was in 98. Now, in 2015, some of those people have since the book came out, some of them have left the Klan. They came to see the light. They understand that they were wrong, and they've left. So I want to go, you know, I want to write about them because I'm still in contact with them and give their stories as to why they left, what made them leave. Also, there have been some new people, you know, who formed new Klan groups and have been hateful and violent and you know, all this kind of thing. Plus, in 98, we did not have a black president. Okay, today we have a black president. That has caused a lot of turmoil in the Ku Klux Klan all across the country. All right, So they have begun recruiting more and more and more because they feel that they're losing their grip on this country. This country country has always had a white power structure ever since George Washington, all the way through George Bush. And now, all of a sudden, you've got this black guy who is at the top of the power structure. The most powerful man in the world is now black. So that has really upset the Ku Klux Klan. That was not happening back in 1998 when my book came out. So I want to include, you know, all that kind of thing and how the Klan feels about that. And that will be included in the new book.
Wow, so you even got in the Klan. You actually went to, did you actually go to Klan meetings, like where they actually would burn the cross? And you actually took part of that. I've seen some videos.
Yes, I did.
How were you allowed there? I guess
because it depends. You know, you have two kinds of rallies. You have a public rally, and you have a private rally. Anybody can go to a public rally, all right? But you probably will not get close because the rally will be surrounded by police. All right, because a lot of protesters will come and they want to fight and, you know, cause a riot and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, there'll be a police line that keeps the spectators away from the Klan. If it's a private rally, you have to be invited by the leader of the Klan. So oftentimes, you know, I've been to both. I've been to public rallies and I've been to private rallies. And the Klan leaders would invite me, you know, to their private rallies on their private property, which nobody can get on unless you're a Klan member or unless you're a special guest who is invited by the head of the Klan. And because I was writing a book, because some of them had come to learn to trust me, I was being honest with them, I was being fair with them, even though I did not agree with them or they did not agree with me, they respected my honesty and my fairness and my knowledge about the Klan, so they would invite me to see the Klan rallies so I could write about it. So that's how I ended up there. And I still go to Klan rallies. I went to one out in Missouri not too long ago, a few months back.
Wow. And I assume the media got a lot of coverage for, like, I'm sure you've gone on, like, you were interviewed many times, right?
Sure, I'm being interviewed right now.
Well, besides now, but, like, have you been in much of the news media? I don't hear about you that much in the mainstream media.
Yeah, I've done Good Morning America, CNN, NBC, CBS, you know, The
wow.
Learning Channel, you know, a bunch of mainstream media. I did a CNN thing about 2 weeks ago that was, you know, broadcast nationally.
Wow, just thinking of that, wow, that is, like, crazy. Like,
then, right before this phone call just now, I just got off the phone with somebody in England who was calling me and interviewed me for 2 hours about the Klan, you know, from London.
Wow, so everybody in the world has probably heard of you.
Well, I wouldn't say that, but, you know, racism in this country
is a cancer.
You know, is well known all over the world.
Racism is a cancer. Like, I'm quoting what you said in one video.
That's right.
Racism is a cancer, and I forgot the rest of that. But,
well, I'll tell you. I say, you know, people always tell me, "Well, Daryl, you know, why don't you ignore the Klan? You know, ignore them. Why?
Yeah. Why don't you burn this? How can I burn this? Like, they ask, why don't you burn the rose? I'm like, well,
right. Because it's history. You know, everybody has their history, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And if it's history, then it must be shown. The truth must be told, even if it's bad. And every country has had some bad things that they have done. And the United States is no exception. So you don't ever want to destroy history. You want to show it so you don't repeat it, especially if it's bad. You know, if you have a cold or a stomach ache and you just ignore it, it will go away. It may take a couple hours, or if it's a cold, it may take a couple days, but it will eventually go away. And things like that you can ignore. If somebody is calling you names or always picking on you like a bully, and you ignore him, if he's not getting the reaction he wants, he goes away. Okay, he goes and picks on somebody else and leaves you alone because he's not getting what he wants out of you. That's fine. There are certain things that you can ignore and they go away. All right, but I made the statement, which you referred to, that racism is a cancer. And if you go to your doctor and you are told that you have cancer, any kind of cancer, brain cancer, lung cancer, you know, whatever, throat cancer, cannot just say, well, I'll ignore it and it'll go away. Because if you ignore cancer, what happens?
It metastasizes.
It metastasizes, and then it consumes your whole body, and then you go away. Racism is a cancer. If you do not address it immediately, it will spread. It will metastasize, and it will consume society. And that's what I'm trying to prevent.
Wow, so and you think all you did, and it was in that time where like there was segregation. It was in the 60s, I assume, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, it was before the 60s, but yeah, on through the 60s and even into the 70s.
So all you did was like talk to KK members. You probably thought you were gonna be beaten up, but like some of them actually like you know put their hand out to you. Hey, I would like to come and talk to you. And you never thought you would be friends with some of them, even like to this day.
I never dreamed of being friends with some of them. I mean, you know, there were some that you know that I had to put in the hospital because they attacked me, and I had to fight to defend myself. There were others I had to put in jail, you know, have them arrested, etc. But there were plenty more though who, you know, were cooperative and would sit down and talk with me. And some of them ended up becoming my friends and quitting. Some of them ended up becoming my friends and are still in the Klan. Some of them are still in the Klan, but you know, would never become my friend, and they will go to their grave, you know, hating and being violent. So you have all types.
Oh wow. So you think anybody could do what you did exactly, or it would be just really hard?
No, absolutely. Anybody can do it. You know, my degree is in music. My degree is not in sociology or psychology. So you don't need a degree in sociology or psychology to know how to treat somebody with respect. But that's the bottom line, is respect. You know, you don't have to respect what they stand for. Because I did not respect what the Klan stood for. But I respected their right to express.
Well, yeah. Something you say, I mean, I agree with it, but I will defend or fight to the death for your right to say it. It's Voltaire.
Right. Right, exactly. And when you give that respect, there's an excellent chance that it will be reciprocated. And then you work from there. So, you know, you can agree to disagree. And you exchange information. And then eventually, because, you know, what you're doing is you're teaching and you're learning. And, you know, you might plant a seed of information with somebody. They may not, you know, so that's a teaching point right there, a teaching moment. They may not learn it right there, but over time, you know, they're thinking about that, and then all, you know, and then maybe a week, months, maybe even a couple years later, they get it. Say, now I know what he was talking about 2 years ago. Yeah, he's right. No, because nobody wants to be wrong. We all want to be right. So they have to reflect upon that. So the learning moment may come much later than the teaching moment. But what's important is that you plant the seed and let it grow. Nurture it so it does grow and eventually it blossoms. And then the light turns on and people see that they're wrong. Or you might learn something from them as well, you know, that gives you a fresh perspective. And you realize, oh, now I understand why he's like that. So maybe I need to address it this way. It gives you another angle. And yeah, but, you know, maybe he's afraid of somebody that has darker skin because some black kid, you know, shot his father, you know, a criminal on the street mugged him or whatever. So then you know, you've learned where his fear comes from. So then you work on that angle to reduce that level of fear that, you know, because one black guy, you know, did something to your family or did something to you is not reflective of the entire black race. You know, it'd be like me saying, okay, because, you know, one Klansman attacked me, you know, therefore I think, you know, the whole white race is racist or something.
That's not the case. You said, you even said in sometimes, like, there are some things that you and the Klan agree on. What are besides, like, what besides a better education, like, what kind of things would you agree on? Because if you would tell somebody that, they'll get, like, the wrong message, because, like, oh, what? Why would you agree with anything with the AK? So, like, how do you deal with that? What exactly would you agree with them?
Well, I explained to them the same thing, you know, better education, getting rid of drugs. Maybe we agree on the same movie being a great movie, or a joke being funny, or, you know, whatever. Or maybe you like the same, you know, you like the same sports team, you know, whatever. You find points that you each that may have nothing to do with race. It just has to do with, you know, society or whatever. You find those points that you agree on, and then you realize, hey, you know, this person really is not that much different than me. The only difference is he thinks he's better than me because he has a different color than I do.
Yeah, and that's obviously not true because you treat everybody equally.
I do, yeah.
Yeah.
But not everybody does.
Unfortunately.
But see, I'm speaking from the other side now. You know, I already know that this Klansman sitting in front of me, you know, who hates me and thinks that he's better and he's more intelligent just because he has white skin, I already know that he's wrong. He doesn't know it. But the more you find, the more he finds that you believe the same way he believes in terms of education, better schools, you know, you put your pants on the same way, you celebrate Christmas the same way he does or whatever, he began to see you as a human being. Because, see, ordinarily, these people would not socialize with a black person. Yes, they have to work with black people. Oftentimes, you know, at their job, you know, there are black people there, there are Hispanic people there, there are gay people there, Asians, you know, whatever, especially, you know, if you live in a big city where you know, you have a multicultural, you know, metropolitan area. So they go to work and they do their job and they may even have to work on a project with a black person, you know, side by side, or somebody else, you know, that they hate, a Jewish person, okay? But I'll guarantee you, when they go to lunch downstairs in the cafeteria, they don't sit with that person. After work, when they punch out and they're on their way home, they stop by some bar for happy hour, they don't go out with the black with their black fellow employees to happy hour. They might go out with their white employees. On the weekends, you know, when they hang out and have parties or go to parties, it's not in a black house, and they don't invite blacks to their house for a party. Okay, so they don't socialize.
That's
they
stupid.
Have to work with these. They have to work with these people because they have to draw a paycheck because they got to pay their mortgage, put food on the table, etc. But when they're on their own, they do not socialize. Well, what I did was I socialized with them. I socialized with them outside of their job. So now they had to see me as a human being. And I saw them as human beings. I saw them as human beings with a different thought pattern, a twisted ideology.
Wow, and like, how did you, I thought, like, if a black guy would talk to a KKK member, wouldn't the black guy be offended easily? So, like, how did you not get offended with him? Or I guess it took time to get used to it. Because, like, for instance, like, as far as movies, Birth of a Nation was a KKK movie. I'm sure he talked to you about that. But, like, how did you not get offended in this stuff? I guess he got turned used to
it. Let me correct something. You never get used to it. You never accept it. You never accept somebody treating you as inferior. You can accept that they believe that way, but you never accept it yourself. No, you don't get used to it. But here's the thing, okay? I realize that I've had more exposure to the world than they have, you know, through my travels, through my interactions with different people. So I'm already ahead of the game. I realize that they lack that. And I know what their mentality is. It's very small because due to lack of exposure. So when I go to a Klan rally or a Klan meeting or I deal with one of them one-on-one, you know, I expect to hear the word nigger, okay? Am I offended by it? Sure, it's offensive. Does it anger me? Does it anger me? No, because I'm expecting it. I know they're going to use that word. I know how they feel. Okay, so when you already have that information in advance, it rolls off your back. You know, you don't let it bother you. Now, if I'm just walking down the street on my way to go grocery shopping and somebody passes me on the sidewalk and calls me a nigger, yes, I'm going to be angry. I'm going to turn around and confront the person. All right, but you know, because that's just out in the public, you know, that shouldn't be. Well, it shouldn't be anywhere. But when you are dealing with a particular group of people whose whole group is formed because they hate black people and they don't like black people, then yes, you're going to expect to hear that. And if you think you're going to go there and not hear it, you're wrong. If you think you're going to go there and get all angry and start fighting them as soon as they call you a name, you're wrong there too, because, you know, that's what they do. And some of them will try to provoke you. They'll try to give you reason to act all crazy. So, you know, when you have that information in advance, it works to your advantage, you know, not to do what they expect you to do. And you rise above. You rise above all that kind of stuff. And then eventually they got to look up to you.
Well, besides talking to KKK members and, you know, getting along with them, you actually a musician as well. You said you say on your website, some of the biggest names in history. Like, who exactly did you meet that's famous? That's amazing.
Well, I mean, the man who invented, you know, the biggest musical genre of all time, the biggest musical genre of all time is rock music, rock and roll. The man who invented rock and roll is Chuck Berry. And I played on and off with Chuck Berry for 32 years.
Wow.
He's still around. He's 88 years old now. And I sat in and played with him, a few months back. He doesn't play that often anymore. But, I played on and off with him for about 32 years.
Wow.
And, you know, many other legendary musicians and some who are not so legendary.
Well, by the way, what are your thoughts on Ferguson?
Well, my thoughts on Ferguson. Daniel Wilson shot Michael Brown. Yes. Officer Daniel Wilson shot Michael Brown, civilian, and killed him. He was a black teenager. To me, it's not so much that he was a teenager. It doesn't matter whether he's an adult or a teenager. He was innocent. He should not have been shot. Michael Brown was, in my opinion, was a criminal. Okay? We saw the video of him roughing up the store clerk and shoplifting. You know, that is not, you know, lawful behavior. Now, Officer Wilson did not know that Michael Brown had already done that when he encountered him on the street and told him to get on the sidewalk or whatever. We will never know exactly what happened. You know, it's almost unbelievable that in this day and age, when everybody has a cell phone, everybody has a video, and et cetera, that this is the one incident of the century that was not captured on video. Seems like everything else is always captured. But this one was not captured on video, and different witnesses say different things. Some say he had his hands in the air. Others say he was bent over and his hand was in his waistband. And he was bent over like he was going to charge Officer Wilson. It could be that you know, Officer Wilson fired several times. It could be that one of the bullets hit him in the stomach, you know, or whatever. You know, anytime you get hit in the stomach, what do? You bend over. So that, you know, that might have caused him to double over and look like he was going to charge when he wasn't. He was falling to his knees. Yeah, we don't know. The only person who really knows at this point is Officer Wilson, because he's the only one who survived the incident. But to answer your question, I strongly feel that the mistake was made in not having a special prosecutor appointed to present that case to the grand jury. The prosecutor who was already in place, Bob McCulloch, there in St. Louis, his father was murdered by a black criminal who killed him. So, of course, you know, I'm not saying that Bob McCulloch is biased, but I'm saying that there is speculation, and reasonable speculation, that he could be biased. So that's why he should have removed himself from the case. Everybody called for him to recuse himself from this case and that a special prosecutor from somewhere else be appointed, and he said no, he would not do it. If you go to a court jury, and let's say a doctor is on trial or a police officer is on trial, the jury is questioned if any member of the jury have they ever worked for the police department, or have they ever worked in the medical field? Is anybody in their family a doctor? Is anybody in their family a police officer? If the answer is yes, they are taken off the jury, and somebody else takes their place, because they don't want anybody too close to the situation, because, you know, they may have an unbiased, they may have a biased opinion and vote based upon their bias, as opposed to being neutral and be able to render an objective decision. That's why you question the jury to find find out if they're close to an occupation or whatever to the defendant. Well, the prosecutor has to work with the police every day. Whenever a prosecutor is in court and a criminal is on trial, and the prosecutor is presenting the evidence against that criminal, where did the prosecutor get the evidence? The police. The police, you know, secure the evidence, give it to the prosecutor so he can prosecute the person and put him in jail or penalize him in whatever method he wants to do. The prosecutor relies on the police to provide evidence. All right? And if the prosecutor does something against the police, it's the prosecutor's job to win every case he prosecutes. And the only way he can win a case is if he has enough evidence to win the case, to secure the conviction. So he has to rely on the police to give him that evidence. Now, if the police are pissed off or upset with the prosecutor, guess what? They don't give him the evidence. They make excuses. That evidence got lost. It got misplaced. We can't find it, or we never had it, or whatever. That is their retaliation against the prosecutor. So it's kind of a unspoken, unwritten practice that we'll look out for you if you look out for us. So the prosecutor's job depends upon how well he successfully prosecutes all his cases. So he has to depend upon the police to help him with that. And if they are upset with him, they don't give him the evidence, and guess what? He loses his case. Some guy may have committed murder, flat-out murder, but if the prosecutor doesn't have the evidence for it, the guy walks. He's found not guilty because the police did not give him the evidence. So it's I'll wash your hand if you wash my hand. So police and prosecutors work hand in hand. And because this prosecutor works with these police officers every day, he should have been off the case when this officer is being brought before the grand jury for possible charges of murder. And the fact that his own father was killed by a black criminal, that should have taken him off the case.
You said something about a special prosecutor.
Yeah, a special prosecutor is someone who is appointed to take the place of the regular prosecutor for whatever reason.
Oh, it's
okay,
neutral.
So if this thing was held in St. Louis, then maybe you would get somebody from some other part of Missouri that has no connection to the St. Louis police or to the Ferguson police. That way, put it this way. If you don't know someone, then you don't owe someone. It's when you know somebody that you feel that you owe them. So, you work hand in hand. If I'm a police officer and I'm off duty, I'm in my own private car, and I'm driving home, and I'm speeding. I'm doing 50 miles in a 30 mile an hour zone, and one of my fellow officers pulls me over. Of course, he doesn't know it's me because I'm in my own private car. I'm not in a marked police car, and he walks up to me and and I pull out my badge and show him, hey, you and I both work for the same department. Or he recognizes me. He's not going to give me a ticket. We're on the same team. I understand that. Okay? And he'll say, hey, slow it down, man. Take off. Get out of here. So, I leave, no ticket. But if you get pulled over and you're not on the police force, you're getting a ticket for doing 50 miles an hour in a 30 mile an hour zone. Okay? So, now, if I'm a police officer and I live here in Maryland, but now I'm on vacation in Massachusetts or somewhere, and I'm speeding in my car, and some Massachusetts police officer pulls me over, he doesn't know me. I'm not on his team. So he may not give me the break that he would give one of his fellow officers. So that's why you need a special prosecutor, someone who does not know anybody on the Ferguson Police Department or the St. Louis Police Department. So you bring that person in and let him present the evidence. Now, does that mean that, it doesn't have to be a black special prosecutor. It could be a white special prosecutor. It doesn't matter. You just need somebody who is not attached to the local scene. All right? And if you brought in the special prosecutor and he presented the evidence and he came up and the grand jury came up with the same conclusion that they were not going to indict Officer Wilson, then that's fine. OK, Okay, you did all you could do. You made it very fair. All right, I feel that if they had done that, there would not have been the rioting and the looting and the destruction of property that we saw in St. Louis. Okay, because what they did was not fair. You used somebody who was connected to the police department to bring before the grand jury. So you gave the impression that you were not even going to try to seek an indictment because you all worked hand in hand. But if they had brought somebody neutral from another location, then the protesters would have seen, okay, well, you know, they're trying to be fair. So, you know, there would not have been the anger and animosity.
Oh.
Because there would not have been a perception of collusion.
And the media always puts it as racial, which is a problem. And you have someone like George Soros, who actually I've done some research. I found out that he gave $33 million to fund the protests. He actually wanted riots and all that.
Who's that?
George Soros. I don't know if you heard of him. He's a billionaire.
George Soros?
George Soros.
I'm not understanding the word you're saying.
Yeah, George Soros. He's a billionaire I think he's pure evil. And he's the one that paid $33 million for the protests. So basically he wanted riots. He wanted a race war purposely.
I'm not familiar with him or his payment. This is the first I've heard of.
Yeah, it's from the Washington Times. Yeah, George Soros funds Ferguson protests.
George Soros.
Yeah, that guy.
I believe all that, though, to be honest with you.
If you're a billionaire, you could do whatever you want.
Yeah, you can do whatever you want, but I don't believe that he would waste his money and time or something like that.
I can only hope they're lying. By the way, what are your thoughts on the quotes? And I think it's silly, but I don't want to sound messed up, but like when it says Black Lives Matter, I find that racist because you're taking only Black Lives Matter. I say all lives matter. But like if you say that, they're like, oh, you're against blacks. All lives matter. We're all created equal. Why do you have to like think as if you're better than anyone else? What do you think on that quote?
Well, it depends upon what context it's used in. Okay? Black lives matter. I can see it from both sides. All right? Because more black lives are being destroyed than white lives in this country for the same crime. All right? You do not hear about a white guy getting shot.
Oh, you're not. That's what I was trying to tell you before, that the media only puts it like victimize the blacks. But I saw a man and his girlfriend being beaten up by five black thugs, and the media did not touch it, which I found racist.
Am I saying that black crime does not exist? Oh, absolutely. There's a lot of black crime. In fact, there is excessive black crime. Okay, but what that is a point. What the statement you made. Black Lives Matter is applying to is to the police. You find more white police officers killing black people than you do white police officers killing white people or black police officers killing white people for the same crime. You don't find now. Is there black crime? Yes, absolutely, no question about it. And it's out of hand, and it needs to be stopped. Okay, but you will not find three examples of a white person holding a cell phone or a wallet being shot 40 times. Okay, you will not find an example of a white man having a toilet plunger rammed up his rectum like happened with the NYPD and Abner Louima in New York a couple years ago. Okay? You won't find four black officers beating up a motorist like the four white officers beat up Rodney King. You're not going to see examples of that. Does it happen? Yeah, maybe once in a while, but not as frequent as it happens to black people. That's why you have that statement, Black Lives Matter. Yes, of course, all lives matter. No question about it.
Yeah, a woman got in trouble for
it. Black people are not anymore exceptional or less than white people. But in this particular instance with the police, okay, black lives tend not to matter as much with them as white lives do. That's why they make the statement. In fact, in many states, and I'll give you this, my state right here where I live now in Maryland, as an example, all right? We used to you committed a capital offense, you could be sentenced to death by, you know, lethal injection or execution, you know, whatever, electrocution, electric chair. But then they found out that more black people were being given the death penalty than white people for the same crime. So they put a 10 years, just recently, within the last 15 years, they put a 10-year moratorium on the death penalty in Maryland, meaning no more death sentences for 10 years while we study this to find out why more black people are being executed than white people for the same crime. Now, what do you need a study for? The answer is obvious. It's racism. All right? Oh, people have been studying black people for 400 years, ever since we were brought over here in chains and leg irons as slaves. We've been studied. We continue to be studied. And if you can't, if it takes you 400 years to figure out that we're being treated unequally, then something is wrong with your system. You know, you're stupid if you can't figure that out in 400 years of studying people. So they did a 10-year study, and they came to the conclusion that yes, it was racially motivated. So now they brought the death penalty back to Maryland. So now we can kill people legally, okay? But they have implemented a system of checks and balances to make sure that, you know, the sentences are fair and balanced, and there is no imbalance between, you know, whites receiving the death penalty, I'm sorry, blacks receiving the death penalty, and whites receiving life in prison or life in prison with parole. So they put in a system to check and make sure that all racial bias is taken out. So yes, black lives do matter, but all, you know, on the whole, all lives matter. All lives matter. But when you are killing a certain segment of the population more often than another segment, then that particular segment matters more so.
I think the quote is being like really overused, because like there was a man that he tortured two, black man tortured two white teens, and he, before the death sentence, he said black lives matter, and the parents of those teens forgave him. Were they afraid to be called racist? Because why would you forgive someone for killing your child? I don't care what color you are. I will never forget that person. I don't know.
Well, you know, it depends upon your belief system. And that's the beauty of this country. You know, we all can have different belief systems. You know, Jesus Christ forgave people. Well, let's get a little more earthly. Martin Luther King, his house was bombed twice. While he was in his bedroom, somebody threw a hand grenade, a firebomb, into his kitchen and blew out everything. Had he been in the kitchen, he would have been dead before he was assassinated, you know, some years later. Twice, his house was bombed. He forgave those people, okay? When he would have a march, a peaceful march, to go and register to vote, to get black people to vote, what happened? People threw rocks at him. The police arrested him. They put dogs on him and fire hoses. He forgave them. Okay? That's him. Now, you know, Malcolm X was a different story. You know, everybody has their own belief system. You might not forgive somebody for doing that. Maybe I would, maybe I wouldn't. Depends upon the situation. But there are those who would.
Yeah, but them in particular, in my opinion, that since society is making, like I said before, like the media is victimizing only blacks, so the parents were afraid to be called racist, so they were like blackmailed. You know, he's black. You have to forgive him, otherwise you'll be called racist.
No, that's entirely not true. Not in this society. People like that. You know, that is something that white racists try to use. You know, to say, oh, well, you know, they forgive him because you know, they don't want to be considered racist because the guy who committed the crime was black, and if they said anything against them, they would be labeled as a racist and da-da-da-da. You know, that is propaganda. That is rhetoric. That is simply not true.
And I'm not even white myself. I'm Hispanic descent. By the way, I see oftentimes on YouTube where somebody would put anti-racist as a code for anti-white. I'm sure you've heard
it. I know the man who put up that billboard. He is the Imperial Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan out in Harrison, Arkansas. And I had lunch with him. I sat down and had lunch with
him
a few months ago.
Wow.
In fact, 2 weeks ago, he and I were on CNN.
No way.
Yeah, his name is Tom Robb.
Wait, so what do you think of that Cold War franchise, White? I think it's because like they were whites were typically known as the racist. So if you're anti-racist, you're technically putting whites on the spot. I asked a teacher on this, with that quote once.
No, I disagree. Again, it's propaganda. It's something that will give him publicity. He has a new billboard out now. He took down the other one, the anti-racist, the Cold War for anti-white. He has a new billboard up now that says white pride radio or something. He has his own radio program. You can dial into it or whatever. But no, anti-racist is not anti-white. Anti-racist is being against someone who feels that their race, regardless of what it may be, is superior to somebody else just because of the difference in somebody's skin. Now, if you really want to be technical about it, all right, there is no such thing as different races. We all, you being Hispanic, me being black, white, whatever, we all are the same race. We may have different characteristics, okay, and we may have different cultures, but there's only one race.
Oh, because there's no such thing as actually being black gene or white gene. There's none of that.
Exactly. Oh. Okay? And that's what needs to be taught in school. Not wait till you get to college to learn that. You start learning that in elementary school. If you do that, people will grow up to be a lot more receptive and acceptive of other people.
And you've gone to conferences around the country. Talking the same story, just like you're telling me. I appreciate
Absolutely.
It. By the way, what are your thoughts on Black History Month? Morgan Freeman came out and said, is there a White History Month or et cetera? So I think he doesn't like that there's a Black History Month. Morgan Freeman, and he's black.
Long before Morgan Freeman said that, I've been preaching that now for almost 14 years, that it is time to get rid of Black History Month. And let me give you the history of it. Okay, a long time ago, no black history was being taught in American schools. It was just called American history. And for all practical purposes, it might have been, it might as well have been called white history, because that's all it was. And a lot of the history was distorted. A lot of it were lies and untruths. Some white people were being given credit for things that they did not discover. They were being given credit for things that they did not invent. For example, we celebrate, I'll get into that a little bit later. They were being given credit for things that, that they should not have been given credit for, all right? And black people who did discover these things or invent those things were not being given the credit. So we had to fight in order to get our people recognized for the contributions that they made to this country. And we fought hard. And they finally gave us 1 week. It was called Negro History Week. And then we fought harder and harder. We had that week for a while. We fought harder and harder. And then finally we got 1 month. The month of February. Okay, the shortest month of the year. And we had 28 days in which to teach black history. Every year, we learn about the same half a dozen black people. Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, Harriet Tubman, Booker T. Washington, George Washington Carver, and one or two other ones. And by the time we get through six or seven black people, the month is over. We did our black thing, let's move on. Mm-hmm. And then we move on into March and on through the rest of the school year. And that's it. We never revisit those black people again until next year, until next February. And it's always the same black people over and over again. I'm not taking anything away. I'm not taking anything away at all from those great black people that we learn about in Black History Month. But what's happening is we learn about Benjamin Franklin, Alexander Graham Bell, Eli Whitney, Thomas Edison, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson all year long. you know, not just in 1 month, all right? So little black kids and little white kids are being brainwashed into believing that there was only a handful of black people that ever did anything in this country. It was just always the same, you know, six or seven every year. What about the man who discovered the, who invented the traffic light or the ironing board or many other things? You know, well, we didn't have time to study him because, you know, we only had 28 days. So a lot of black inventors and discoverers are being omitted because of the time frame. So I'm saying it's time to get rid of Black History Month and take that information and spread it out under its proper place, which is called American history, because it is as much American history as anything else, and it should be taught all year long, just like anything else. Okay, right now we got a black president. All right, next year he will end his presidency. So in the future, is America only going to study Barack Obama in February because he's black, so therefore he belongs in black history? How stupid is that? How far has this country come if we allow that to happen? Okay? We're supposed to be the most progressive country in the world. Come on. So we're only going to put black people in their own little box in February?
No. We learn about everybody. We learn about nobody. That's how I see it. We got to do it. We learn about everybody, or it's better just don't. We don't learn about anybody.
I agree with you 100%. So let's be fair to everybody. Let's put everything under American history. Study Native Americans. Study Hispanic Americans. Study Asia Pacifica Americans. Black Americans. White Americans. Whatever. Spread it all out throughout the entire school year. Make it all part of history. Make everybody equal, and then everybody will have equal respect for each other.
And I don't know if I'm wrong in some cases where it's. Oh, if it's Black History Month or Hispanic Heritage History Month, which I think it's on October. But I'm not big on it. I'm Hispanic. My parents will go crazy. But I'm like, I treat everybody equally. I don't need to have too much like pride on a race. I think of myself as a human being. But like, I'm not big on Black History or Hispanic History Month. I'm not big on it. But like, I just don't think it's why is the big deal? I guess it's personally.
Well, you know, it is a big deal because there are a lot of great Hispanic people who have contributed to the building and the fabric of this country. And they should be recognized. But instead, they're being swept under the carpet, and a white person is being recognized. Because whites are the power structure. I'm not saying this as a racist, yeah, 'cause I'm not a racist. I'm just stating how it is. Okay? Everybody needs to have an equal amount of time. Because the reason why this country is as great as it is because people from different cultures have built it. Huh?
All walks of life.
Exactly. So all walks of life should be represented, and they don't need to have their own month because they all are American. So it should all be part of American history. Hispanic heritage should be part of American history. You know, black history should be part of American history. Euro-American history should be part of American history. You know, whatever. It all should be part of American history. Now, back to what I was saying, so I'll give you another example. Okay. You know, for a very long time, this country was resistant to creating Martin Luther King Day. You know, which was, a couple weeks ago, right?
Yep.
All right. Why? Why did they not want to honor?
They were not ready to accept change, real change yet, I think.
Exactly. So what you're telling me is the country is racist, and you're absolutely right. All right? But there's more to it than that. All right? Martin Luther King is the only American man who has a holiday all to himself.
Whoa.
And guess what? He's black. Okay? He's the only American man that has a holiday all to himself, and he's black. And the racist part of America cannot accept that. Even to this day, they cannot accept that. Now, there used to be two white men who each had a holiday all to himself, and that was okay. We used to have George Washington Day, and then we had Abraham Lincoln Day.
I would like that, okay? And I'm not white. I would like to have those two, and they're the founding fathers.
Okay,
and I'm not white.
Anyway. Okay, right, but there were two distinct separate days. and Abraham Lincoln Day. Okay, and then they got combined into one day, and it's called President's Day. All right, that's where President's Day came from, the combining of Washington Day and Lincoln Day. All right, so now there are no white people that have, no single white person has a holiday all to himself. That honor is reserved for a black man, okay, a black American man. So people don't like that. All right, now, get this. There is one man in this country who does, besides Martin Luther King, who does have a holiday all to himself. However, he's not an American. All right? Mm. Martin Luther King gave his life to bring everybody together peacefully. White, black, Native American, whatever, together peacefully. All right? And people did not want to honor him by giving him a day. Yet, they will honor another man, a white man, who was a murderer and who was a rapist and who did not discover anything. Because how do you discover something when you get here and people are already here?
Oh, yet he's given, but
who am I talking about?
You know, Daryl, I can't hate Christopher Columbus, not to mention my name is Christopher. Christopher,
I didn't imply you know that you should hate him, but I'm saying do not give him credit for what he does not deserve. Christopher Columbus did not discover America. People were already here. Native Americans were already here. He did not discover anything. And furthermore, on his voyage over here on the Nino, the Pinto, and the Santa Maria, he murdered, pillaged, and raped people. And that's a fact, and we know that. So, yet we're going to give this man his own holiday, and yet we tried to refuse to give a peaceful man who wanted to bring everybody together, who never murdered anybody, and who never raped anybody, we want to deny him a holiday. All because of the color of his skin. And Christopher Columbus's skin is the same color as the majority of people in this country.
Oh, and as far as interracial couple goes, I've seen a video on CNN. You are married to a white woman, and
that is correct.
Yeah, what's your thoughts on interracial couple? I believe we all create equal.
Well, obviously, you know what they are. I married one, right?
Yeah.
I have no problems with it. You know, I choose who I want to be with, not based on skin color, but based on compatibility. And it doesn't matter to me what anybody else thinks. I don't live in some country where marriages are arranged and you have to marry this person because that person gave my father X amount of dollars or a bunch of cows or whatever else, and so therefore I'm obligated to marry whoever they choose. No. In this country you can marry whoever you want to marry.
Wow.
And I've dated women from all over the world, every different color, every different religion, whatever.
Wow, and eventually your family had to accept that, of course. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't.
My family was already acceptive, even as a child, because that's how I was raised.
Ah.
You know, some people who are racist, yeah. You know, their family, they were racist because their family was racist, and they were raised racist, and they had to break out of it. And so when they broke out of it, and they started, you know, dating other people or whatever, their family would not accept them. Okay, my family was never like that from the get go. So it's not a question that my family would have to accept it. My family accepted it long before I was even born.
Wow.
So that's how they raised me. They raised me to accept people based upon, as Martin Luther King said, the content of their character, not the color of their skin.
Yep. And what are your thoughts on Toni Morrison? I don't know if you've heard of her. Yeah, she doesn't believe that race is just a social construct, which obviously,
we
said before. And she was on the Colbert show, Stephen Colbert, and she was talking about her book. And what are your thoughts on her?
I think she's wonderful. Absolutely. It is a social construct. You know, we mentioned that earlier. You know, there's no such thing as race. You know, if there is, it's only one. It's the human race, as opposed to an animal race. Or a mammal race or something.
Well, so why can't? Because you said before that, like, if people are prideful,
okay, though. This way, you know, back in the 1950s, a lot of black people in this country, especially entertainers and things like that, moved to France and took up residency in France. Why? Because the French people treated them equally. They didn't view them as black people. They viewed them as human beings. Where in their own country, they were viewed as subservient, as second-class citizens. So they left the United States and moved to France. So the race thing is something that is pretty much, you know, here. Yeah, there are other countries that have some racial problems, but most of the countries, you know, that have problems like that are not so much racist as it is religion. You know, like here in our country, you know, I don't know what religion you are, but let's say you're Catholic and I'm Protestant. It doesn't matter. You and I get along fine. There's no issue. Okay? But over in Ireland and the UK, you know, they are very violent with one another, Protestants and Catholics. They bomb one another. Okay? And in Lebanon, it's Christians and Muslims. And in Israel, it's Jews and Arabs, you know, whatever. So, you know, there are different issues, you know, that are non-racial. It could be, you know, religious. But over here, it's the same thing, except it's black and white. We care less whether you're you know, Catholic or Protestant.
And could it be, like, in movies, like even, I don't know, in my opinion, I've seen, like, movies like Star Wars, where I don't hear anybody say, oh, that's a black man, that's a white man. I don't see, like, Star Wars, they would accept everybody. There's no such thing as black or white in Star Wars, I think. I know.
But see, Star Wars takes place way in the future, when we hope there'll be no more racial problems.
Oh, wait,
you know, it'll be people with pointy heads against people with flat heads. You know, it'll be some other stupid bigotry. Maybe some, you know, people with three eyes who discriminate against people with two eyes.
Well, and of course, what are your thoughts on Al Sharpton? He is the opposite. He is a race baiter. I think he is the racist one. He's a race baiter. He wants to, like, turn whites against blacks, etc. What are your thoughts on him?
Well, let me ask you why. I'll give you my thoughts on it, but let me ask you, why do you say that?
What?
That you think that he is a race baiter. He's trying to turn blacks and whites against each other.
Yeah, because it's like, because of him, like, I feel like him and the media, like, together, like, they make it look as if it's black against white, but, you know, but I don't, it's, when it comes to the Ferguson stuff, he talked as if it's, like, as if it's, like, blacks are more better than whites in a way. Like, he was, like, he's not bringing people together, and isn't, like, that's an issue. That's something I was concerned about, I guess. I don't know.
I've never heard him encourage people to fight. I've marched with them before. I never heard him encourage anybody to start rioting and breaking out windows and attacking the police and looting and firebombing buildings and all that kind of stuff. I've never heard him say anything like that. Let me ask you a question. You, of course, remember the Trayvon Martin case?
Yes, I remember.
The only reason you know about Trayvon Martin is because of Al Sharpton, okay? What happened to Trayvon Martin happens in this country all the time. Somewhere is happening right now as we are speaking on this phone, okay?
Yes.
But the only reason you heard about Trayvon Martin is because of Al Sharpton. He went down to Florida and he publicized that case. And since that time, that George Zimmerman, he's been arrested numerous times since he shot and killed Trayvon Martin. He got arrested a couple weeks ago for putting a gun to somebody's head. You heard about that, right?
Oh.
If you haven't, Google him. He got arrested about 2 weeks ago, George Zimmerman. He put a gun to somebody's head. Okay, he's constantly getting in trouble. The only reason we heard about Trayvon Martin is because of Al Sharpton. It's time that, you know, you might as well say that Martin Luther King was a race baiter, because all he did was go around the country having marches and sit-ins and protests. You know, these people are trying to bring to attention the imbalance of treatment in this country. Now, if he people going around saying, hey, you know, we got to take up arms. You know, we got to stand up and fight the police. And, you know, and if we don't get our way, then, you know, we need to, you know, burn down some buildings and go in the stores and loot stuff. You know, I would agree with you. But I can't agree that he is a race baiter. Al Sharpton is a very, very intelligent man.
You talking?
Has he made some mistakes? Yes. Do I agree with everything that he has said and done? No, I do not. But he is not a racist. He is a very intelligent man. And he is trying to bring attention to things that are imbalanced in this country that would otherwise be swept under the carpet.
Wow. And as far as, I guess, do you know him personally?
Yes, I do.
Oh, wow.
I mean, I wouldn't say I'm friends with him, but yes, I've met him on a few occasions.
Oh. Because I would always think of him and the media, how, like, he's getting a lot of backlash. I guess maybe he's not racist, but, like, I guess in a way, I didn't feel that he was bringing people together necessarily. So, like, maybe I be biased on him? I don't know.
You got to understand, the media has a problem. The media, you know, what you see in the media today, how old are you?
I'm 20.
Okay. Well, I'm 56. So what you have seen in the media, on the news, is nothing at all like what I would see on the news when I was 20 years old. When I was 20 years old, the news was the news. You know, what was being reported was what was happening, okay? And they reported it as it happened, not as they thought it should be. Today, we're not getting news, we're getting commentary. The anchor people are giving their opinions, you know, about what's happening and why this person did that and how this person behaves and da-da-da-da, instead of just reporting the story. We're getting commentary. That's why you see, you know, different twists on Fox News than you would see on CNN, which might be a little different twist than you would see on MSNBC, because everybody's giving their opinion instead of just giving the news. So, because now they are competing for ratings. See, when I was 20, you know, your whole life, you've known cable TV, all right? There was a time when I was living when there was no cable TV. It was just network TV, ABC, NBC, and CBS, and PBS. That was it. Okay, so there really wasn't a whole lot of competition. And now with cable TV, Fox News, MSNBC, CNN, HLN, on and on and on, all these people compete with each other, so, you know, for ratings. And so, therefore, they sensationalize a lot of stuff. It is in their interest to put somebody in a position like an Al Sharpton or like a Bill O'Reilly or like a Rush Limbaugh or you know, a Colbert or whoever, Glenn Beck, and all these people, you know, to portray them in a certain way in order to create stories and sensationalize, because that way they get the ratings and they start stuff and they have news. One time when my book first came out, Clandestine Relationships, I was being interviewed by a national news media. I forgot now whether it was CNN or another one, and also People Magazine were interviewing me. And all of a sudden, they had to break and drop the interview because the story just broke that that our president, who was at the time was Bill Clinton, had been accused of having an affair with this girl named Jennifer Flowers. This was not Monica Lewinsky, but Jennifer Flowers. And so that became the big news. And then that whole time, then Monica Lewinsky came in and all this other stuff. So one of the guys who came over to my house to interview me, one of the cameramen, he told me, he says, thank God for Monica Lewinsky. He had made over $100,000 in overtime just following Monica Lewinsky around, you know, because she was going in and out of court testifying against Bill Clinton. And so he was the cameraman for this news show or whatever. And, you know, I live right here 20 minutes from Washington, D.C., so I'm right here in the thick of it all. He made over $100,000 because of Monica Lewinsky, having to, because she was always in the news. And so with that $100,000, part of it, his wife always wanted a swimming pool in their yard. He was able to pay cash and get her a swimming pool. You know, so it's that kind of sensationalism that the media lives for today instead of living for the news like it was when I was 20 years old. And that's why you see a lot of the publicity and race baiting and all that kind of stuff surrounding Al Sharpton and some other people in the news.
What can you tell me about Jeremiah Wright, pastor? Because I remember when he was at one video.
I know who he is. I never met him. He was the pastor of the church, you know, where Obama attended.
He once saw this video where he said, "Damn America, that's in the Bible." And I'm like, that's the guy who said that.
Yes, right. And the roosters roosters have now come home to roost, right? Or the chickens have come home to roost. Well, that's what he said. Well, and what he was saying is, what goes around comes around.
Oh, because he was saying that America's like killing like innocent people. And in a way, he was right. In the Middle East, because of war in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Listen, any war, whether we're involved in it, whether we start it, or whether we go into war in response against somebody else who started it, war kills a lot of people. And if we participate in war, then yes, we will kill a lot of people. Some of those people will be enemies who are attacking us, and some of them will be innocent bystanders, men, women, and children who just happen to be caught in the crossfire, and they're innocent. And that is tragic. War is tragic, which is why war should be avoided at all costs.
And by the way, what about Louis Farrakhan? Another one where a pastor where he said, if they could go to Wendy's and have a burger and go to sleep, they will keep killing us. So in a way, he was probably trying to incite something.
Louis Farrakhan, you know, he's a black supremacist, and there's not much difference between black supremacy and white supremacy. In fact, Louis Farrakhan gets along fine with some Klan leaders. Louis Farrakhan, believe it or not, has spoken at some Klan rallies, okay? Because they get along. Because they both believe in separation of the races. So they respect each other's ideology in keeping each person's race pure. So they have mutual respect. But there's not much difference between black supremacy and white supremacy. To me, I think they both are wrong and they both are idiots.
I don't believe that people should be like segregated. I think you should be able to talk to whoever, like if that person is respects you and love whoever you want to love. Like
that, absolutely, I agree.
That's why I go with Toni Morrison. Like, does it make sense if you say like raceless? I don't feel like why should I be classified as Hispanic or black or white? I'm classified as a human being.
As an American, you know, whatever, or you're a male. You know, you're a male American.
And what about James David Manning, pastor from Outlaw Media Network? Yeah, I don't know if you've heard of him.
Yeah, I've heard a few of his things. I think he's someone who just likes publicity. So, you know, when everybody else goes one way, he goes the other.
Oh, wait, what do you mean?
I mean, that you know, he draws a lot of attention, you know, with his rants about Obama and his rants about this, that, and the other. You know, some things may have a shred of truth to them, while other things don't. And I feel that that certain things he's saying is just so he can get an audience and get publicity.
Sort of like
Rush Limbaugh. You know, you can take anything out of context and twist it around and make a big deal out of it, and the next thing you know, you've got, you know, if you're on the radio, or, you know, you might get 1 million listeners. If you're on TV, you might get 10 million listeners or viewers.
Wow.
So, you know, you use the media to your advantage. It's like, you know, some people, for example, some people will run for president, you know, every election, and they know they don't stand a chance of getting the nomination. But yet they'll put their name on the ballot. So if you know you're not going to win, no one's ever heard of you, why would you run for president? Because you know if you put your name on the ballot, a lot of people will hear about you. And it will draw publicity to you for whatever else it is you're trying to do. You're not going to make it as president. No one's going to vote for you because no one, nobody, nobody have your name on the ballot, and the fact that you'll get on TV and have a couple commercials about you, or you get interviewed on Good Morning America or the Today Show or whatever, you will get some publicity. So when you get on there, you name some other thing, you know that you're in charge of or that you want to do, and you will attract people. That's why people do this, for publicity. I believe that some of these preachers and some of these people, some of them believe what they're saying, and there are others who are just on the publicity bandwagon to make a name for themselves, sort of the way you feel Al Sharpton is doing.
Oh, and as far as, you and the KKK, is there, a documentary on this? Do you think there'll be, a movie on this?
There are a couple of documentaries in the works that hopefully will come out sometime this year.
Wow. By the way, I told you off air, how can you actually be able to talk to KKK members, even though you're not black, or even though you're not white, or you're not Daryl Davis. So do I have to so I guess it's just a matter of talking, right? Or I don't know. Or do I have to go with you to talk to a Klan member? How would that work?
Wait, tell me again what you're asking.
If you were wanted to talk to a Klan, just you did, how would you go about doing that with a soul?
If you want to talk to a Klan member?
Yeah, and me or anybody else. Unless they're Daryl Davis, you probably won't go anywhere. So do I have to be recommended by you or something? Or you just...
No, not at all. Daryl Davis is nobody. I'm not any different than anybody else. What you would do is you would simply contact, the Klan member or members, that you want to that you want to talk to. Email them or call them on the phone and state your intention and see if they would consent to sitting down and talking with you or replying to your email or whatever. Some will, some won't.
What are your thoughts on the Black Panthers party? I know the recent one is not as good as the one from Louis Pinckney, I think it was his name. He was the leader of the old Black Panther party.
You know, with the Black Panthers?
Yeah, what are your thoughts on the Black Panthers?
Now, understand,
Larry.
What we have now is something called the New Black Panther Party. And I know the leader of that party. I've marched with him too. His name is Malik Shabazz. And I think he just stepped down as leader. But I don't agree with his ideology. I know him personally, and I've marched with him. We marched together against police brutality and police violence. And he's a very smart individual. I think he has a lot of race issues. But I don't believe in any kind of supremacy, like I said, black supremacy or white supremacy. And the New Black Panther Party, tends to be more black supremacists. Now, the New Black Panther Party, which is what it's called today, should not be confused with the original Black Panthers from the 1960s. It's a whole different group, whole different philosophy.
Larry Pinckney was the leader.
Pardon me?
Larry Pinckney.
Well, there were a lot of them. There was Huey Newton, Bobby Seale, Eldridge Cleaver, of the original Black Panther Party.
What's the difference between the old one and the one now?
Well, the old one was born out of oppression, where blacks were being, arrested for nothing, being shot and beat up by police. The communities were being raided, they were being set up, and all this other kind of stuff. So the Black Panther Party was born to protect black people from the white establishment that was abusing them. And, they were not out to attack anybody and fight anybody. They were there to defend. And they were not black supremacists. They were protectors. They provided education for black kids, because a lot of white schools would not allow the black kids in them. So they took them in and tutored them, provided, food and, breakfast meetings, education, drug awareness, all these other kind of programs for the betterment of the black community. The New Black Panther Party is not doing that.
Oh, and they're just doing what the KKK did 200 years ago. You heard of the Little Rock Nine, where
of course.
Yeah, and she like, it had to be the military to like escort
the
them
National
inside.
Guard
yeah, National Guard.
Into the school. Yeah.
And eventually her and the woman that was yelling in her face, they became best friends.
I'm sorry, Sandy, I couldn't hear you.
The woman who was, I think she was the oldest one who was being yelled at by yeah. a white woman. She became friends with her eventually.
Yeah. So see, people can change. So can't you forgive somebody?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
Well, but one of the stuff that could be unlikely is like if a Black Panther would want to meet with a KKK member, that's probably not going to happen anytime soon.
They talk from time to time. Like I said, the ideology is the same. They don't like each other's color, but the ideology is the same.
They want a better society.
Pardon me?
They want a better society. They want better.
Well, everybody wants a better society. But some people think a better society is getting rid of everybody that does not look like you, and that's where I have an issue.
Oh, but they do want things to be better, like better education. That's no doubt. They want better education. They want better, like, everything for everyone. But I think it's always racial. That's the problem.
And that's why we have to stand together in order to get it.
But the thing is, like, it's all as like. Do you think the world will change one day? Because it's always racial. If it's black this or white that, like, I think we should all be treating each other equally. And I don't even want to use the word race. I want everybody to recognize themselves as human beings. I don't have to say he's white or he's black.
Yeah, I agree with you. But that is, I agree with you 100%. But that is a long ways off. Because what you have to understand is this stuff did not just start during the 20 years of your life. It's been going on since 1865 and before. Not 1965, 1865, when slavery ended. Blacks have been discriminated against for that long and are still discriminated against. So it's not just the 20 years that you've been around. There's a long history of that. So because it's such a long history, it's going to take a long time to change. If it just started last week or something, yeah, we could fix it next month. But when you have that many years... not even that many years, not even that many decades, that many centuries of oppression and racism, you're not going to change it overnight. So take a while.
And what do you think about the NAACP?
What do I think about them?
Yeah.
Well, they are fragmented. There's some things I agree with, some things I do not agree with. Some of them have challenged me on what I do. Others understand what I'm doing, so they're kind of fragmented. They were initially a very good organization, that stood for the betterment of black people in this country. And one thing I have to give to the NAACP, they have white members. In fact, two Jewish people helped found the NAACP. Okay, Spingarn was one of them. And so the NAACP, welcomes anybody and everybody to join and work together for the betterment of, quote-unquote, colored people, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. And any race, any color can join. Unlike the Klan, which works for the betterment of white people, only white people can join.
Even though you can join the KKK, but you could be allies in a way.
Yeah.
Is it true that the NAACP supports Planned Parenthood? Which I think it's stupid because Planned Parenthood...
Supports what?
Planned Parenthood.
Officially supports them? Like the NAACP would endorse that? I don't know. I mean, you'd have to speak to the presidency of the NAACP. But I'm sure that there are individual members who would support it and there would be individual members who would not support it.
But it's not the abortion. Is that the founder, Margaret Sanger, she was actually racist. She wanted to eliminate blacks. Anybody who's not white.
Who's that?
The founder of Planned Parenthood, Margaret Sanger.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And the
Red Cross at one time was racist. The Red Cross, at first, the Red Cross would not accept black blood. Wow. And then, when they began accepting black blood many years later, they segregated the blood. They would not mix black blood with white blood. Today they do, because they realize, you know, AB positive and O negative or whatever is the same, whether it comes out of a black body, a Hispanic body, or a white body. But a long time ago, they would not accept blood from a black person, and then when they did accept it, they segregated it. So, you know, people grow, people evolve.
Yeah, but when she said she considered anybody who, as human weeds, she said, quote, inferior races are Orientals, black Jews and blacks. She referred to them as human weeds. Like, Margaret Sanger founded Planned Parenthood. Why would you support someone who wants to do away with anyone who's not white? Isn't that hypocritical?
No, not necessarily, because you support the idea, not necessarily the person.
Well, what exactly is the idea of the Planned Parenthood? It's just abortion? You're supporting the woman's right to choice?
Well, a lot of people believe in that. A lot of people believe in abortion.
Yeah, I believe that it should be like someone's choice. I just didn't want to, you know, someone founded the Planned Parenthood who was racist, so I thought that would be a double standard. Well, the NAACP supports black people or in particular black people, so why would you support someone, organization founded by someone who is racist who actually didn't want black people to exist? So I think that would be hypocritical.
Have you ever watched any John Wayne movies?
I don't know much about John Wayne. I've heard of him, though.
Okay, yeah, because you're young. You don't remember John Wayne. John Wayne, look him up. Ask anybody older than you what they thought of John Wayne. A lot of people consider John Wayne to be a hero, an American hero. He was an actor, and he had a lot of movies out. John Wayne was also a white supremacist. So, you know, you would say, well, why watch his movies? If you found out that the man who invented the telephone, Alexander Graham Bell, if you found out that he was a racist, which he probably was back in that time, would you use his invention?
Well, whether you don't want to or whether you want to or not, like, you have to use a phone, so...
No, you don't have to use a phone. You can use telegraph, you can use email, you can use a walkie-talkie. You know, you can use the mail system, you know, mail somebody a letter, whatever. You know, believe it or not, there are some people who don't have phones today because they don't want them, not because you know, he was a racist or whatever. But the idea is this. There are some racists who have some very good ideas. So you support the idea, not the person.
Wow, I didn't know that Bell would actually be racist guy, but like...
I don't want you to quote me on that. I'm not saying that he was a racist. I'm saying, given the era in which he lived, you know, when back when blacks were slaves and this, that, and the other, or just coming out of that, they were not treated equally, so there was a good chance that he could have been a racist. Not saying he was. I don't know whether he was or not.
Oh, and like, what are your thoughts on political correctness? Because like, Britain is really tough on this.
I'm not politically correct at all.
Because the thing is, like, if it would offend someone, if it's like something, if you don't agree on somebody that comes to somebody that is black or gay, they think you're racist or homophobe, and people can actually like give you a bad reputation because of that. What do you think of that? Political correctness is just stupid.
I think it's stupid.
Of course, but people don't realize because, like, the people don't want to know be honest to one another because they are afraid to be offended.
They may hurt somebody's feelings.
But what is up with that, though? That's why we're not evolving ourselves.
No, it's not evolving. It's devolving. You know, like I said, it's setting people backwards. No, you know, I don't believe in political correctness. I think it's ridiculous.
How do you think we could get rid of it? Political correctness?
By not using it, by not catering to it. If somebody tells you're politically incorrect, you say, I don't care. I'm correct from my point of view. You want to know the truth from me? I'm giving you the truth. You want to put it in some category? That's your business.
Wow. And before you go, what message would you have to say to everyone who's listening?
I would have to say, you know, be yourself. Believe in what you believe in. Don't be afraid to speak your mind, but also listen to others, even if you disagree with them. Give them the time of day. Let them air their views. Listen to them. Learn from them, and also teach them your points of view. Keep the lines of communication open. Keep on talking, even with your worst enemies. Like I said earlier, when two people are talking, they're not fighting. It's when the fighting stops that the violence begins. So we all can learn from each other. We all can teach from each other. And we will become great when we learn to work with each other. And we learn to love each other. Because to me, I cannot get over how we can talk to somebody as far away as the moon, or how we can talk to somebody halfway around the planet Earth on our cell phone, or on our email, or on a satellite phone if we talk to somebody out in outer space, how we can talk to people at that distance, but yet we cannot talk to the person who lives right next door to our house because he or she is a different sexual persuasion or different religion or different color. So we need our ideology to catch up to our technology. Our technology is way ahead of our ideology. And we are living in the 21st century. We are living in space age times, but there are still too many of us still thinking with stone age minds.
Wow. that I couldn't have said it better myself. Thank you very much, Daryl Davis. I hope to have you on again. And
sure, anytime, Christopher. My pleasure. Call me anytime.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much, Daryl.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, that was Daryl Davis. I bet you guys never thought I would have him on. Like when I said in the broadcast maybe a few weeks ago, how a man could be friends with a Klan member, but you know he's black. It's not so much of a miracle. It's about how you communicate with each other. You know, it doesn't matter what belief you have or if you're not a believer. But how can we talk to each other as a humanity, as a fellow man? You know, we gotta figure out how to get along with each other, no matter what you look like, no matter what you are. So, what do you think we should do? Whoever's listening, what do you think we should do? Are we gonna evolve to the future, or are we just gonna bomb the crap out of each other and it's going to be mad hatred and, like, to quote George Carlin, a failed mutation? Come on, guys. We're better than that. Seriously.